All right, welcome everyone to our session on how to help students discover the joy of statistics with PsycLearn. We're happy to have you here with us today. I'm just going to start with a few housekeeping items. We want to hear from you, so please engage us in the chat, engage with other instructors and our presenters. We'll be monitoring the chat. We also have a Q&A functionality, so if you have a question about anything, it's a great place to leave it. We'll address them live at the end. We'll have a Q&A moment for everyone to participate. We will be recording this session, and it will be made available on demand. You will also be receiving an email with the recording by the end of this week or early next week. So please just keep that in mind. You'll be able to share it with colleagues if any of your colleagues couldn't be here today. And just a quick introduction to everyone who will be joining us on this call today. My name is Andrea Bergoa. I am the Course Adoption Marketing Manager here at APA Publishing. I just recently joined the team last month. I'm joined by Nicole Smutney, who is our online learning training and support specialist, as well as Linda Goldberg, our senior product evangelist. And we will also be joined by Dr. Laura Pople, our director of learning design here at APA. She has been with APA since August 2018 and has so much great experience in the higher ed space. And also has a lot of experience teaching in the discipline. We're also joined today by Dr. Jodie Ullman. She's an editorial advisor for PsycLearn Statistics, as well as an emerita professor of psychology from CSU San Bernardino, executive officer of the Western Psychological Association. I could go on and on and on, but we're so pleased to have her here today. So welcome, Jodie. And just a quick overview of what we're going to talk about today. We're going to hear a little bit about PsycLearn, as well as get a demo of the student experience in PsycLearn. Then we'll hear from Jodie about her vision for student success in statistics and how she helps students find the joy of statistics. And then we'll hear from Laura talking about manifesting student success with the PsycLearn course and the development of PsycLearn here at APA. And then we'll end with a Q&A. And as I mentioned, you don't have to wait for the Q&A to ask questions. Please use the Q&A functionality. You can also use the chat if there's something that you want everyone to hear. And we're happy to have you here. I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Linda to talk about an overview of PsycLearn. So take it away, Linda.
All right, thank you, Andrea. So first, what I want to do is just share a little bit of background. The sort of lead up to our decisions to develop PsycLearn. APA is not really new to higher education. We've, since 1952, published the APA publication manual. And so that represented at that time the beginning of a long tradition of our outreach to and support in education of college students in psychology and the overall academic endeavor in psychology, frankly. Developing and offering digital solutions is also not new to APA. We have developed and supported access to PsycInfo, the database of psychology information, and deliver that on the PsychNet platform in addition to other partner platforms. And APA Style Central, which is now known as Academic Writer, is another digital undertaking that we took to create and deliver a writing tool for both instruction and accomplishing the research and writing process. Something that we recognized as we contemplated taking on this project was the disruption in the instructional area, the disruption that technology was bringing and textbook price pressure. And so we felt that we were really well positioned, given the experience that we had, to give some focus to developing affordable psychology course content for psychology students. Next slide. And so we laid out a few goals, had some goals in mind when approaching the project. Something that we recognized early on was the time pressure that students feel, today's college students. And so we wanted to ensure that we could facilitate efficient and effective study time. We know, for instance, through research that the reading and highlighting and rereading process is not terribly effective means of study for students. And so as we took on this project, we were seeking to find a way that would promote students' use of better study strategies and felt that we could foster that with a digital solution. Something else we had in mind was accountability, the need for accountability. We heard from instructors some sense of frustration that that comes with not knowing whether students are actually doing reading assignments, or so often students maybe not even choosing to purchase a book. And therefore, a mechanism that helps to ensure that students are making their way through independent study seemed important to us. Another goal that we set for this this undertaking and an outcome that we wanted to see through it was to promote use of active and applied class time experiences. And so here our thought process was that by helping to ensure that students are gaining some introduction to concept knowledge in their independent study time, that would help to afford instructors more latitude for bringing active and applied activities to class time. It would help perhaps not eliminate, but perhaps limit somewhat the need for lecture instruction and lecture time, class time being the first introduction of concepts, if concepts are covered well in student study time. And so these are just some of the sort of underpinning outcome goals that we hope for the product. And next slide. So I'm just gonna mention a few notable features of the PsycLearn platform. PsycLearn, we now offer course material for research methods as well as statistics. Our main focus today will be our content for statistics, but the platform for both products have these common features. So we'll see them a little more up close in the demo that Nicole has planned for us in a few minutes, but I just wanna provide some highlights to some of these, beginning with the multimodal practice opportunities in the form of formative self-assessments. After each concept is introduced, these offer for students what we might could consider a pause moment that prompts students to do something with new knowledge just covered. These activities take the form of embedded videos, interactive activities, whiteboard demonstrations in some cases, and algorithmically generated math problems. Some of these activities are very basic, and others move into more complex stages. I like to think of this as the wiffle ball approach to skill building, where, as I said, some of the activities are very basic, but that's where we all begin our skill building, is something that's a very basic engagement with new knowledge, with content or skill. Each module contains several mastery problem sets spaced throughout. Mastery problem sets set a bar of achievement a little bit higher than the formative self-assessments. And so students receive credit only after achieving a certain level of mastery. And these are directly tied to specified learning objectives that are outlined clearly for students in the beginning of a module of content. Each module provides students with supplemental content. This is something that we consider sort of as needed and on demand, designed to offer an alternative explanation or alternative examples to extend learning opportunities for complex topics. So when students are feeling that something's unclear, they can choose to move along a path that gives them the chance to engage with reinforcing content. There are mechanisms to monitor student progress through content. This is in the way of a progress notation percentage that is passed back into the course management system. And each of our course titles is accompanied by test bank questions and a set of applied activities. These student activities include sometimes 2 to 4 assignments, which can be used as homework or in-class assignments. They're 2 to 4 aligned to the learning objectives of each module. And so an instructor has those to choose from to assign as homework or to bring into the classroom. Some are designed to be group activities even. And so in summation, PsycLearn is designed to be a textbook replacement, not a digital supplement, but to provide the content for student independent study, as well as interactive reinforcements, not to be a teacher replacement, but simply a textbook replacement. We'd like to think of it as a companion tool for engaged instruction and a teacher enabler. And so with that, I'm going to turn it over to Nicole to provide us with a demonstration.
Thanks, Linda. All right, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen with the table of contents for PsycLearn statistics. In PsycLearn statistics, there are 14 full modules of content in statistics for students. There's an acknowledgments module, the APA student resources, which was referred to on Linda's last slide, and then the PsycLearn orientation lesson. The orientation lesson is a good way to get students started so that they kind of understand how the whole process is going to go. I'm going to give you a quick overview of what a module looks like. I'm going to work with module 8, the one sample t-test. So every module in PsycLearn starts and ends the same. It starts with a learning plan, which has a brief video that goes over an overview of the content, what it is that you're going to be learning about in this module. It also has those learning objectives that Linda was talking about, where they are fully explained, like, this is what you're going to do working through the content here in this module. Every single one has specific measurable outcomes that align with the information presented and the content shared in the module. The end of the modules also end with a learning summary. It gives a overview of all of the learning objectives, the formulas that were used in this module, terms and definitions, flashcards, cumulative assessment questions for students to review, and of course our references as well. So that's how every single module starts and ends. On that learning path in between that learning plan and that module summary is where we're going to see some information where they're going to preview content, go through some lecture pieces, have some specific practice questions for each content, and then a mastering the content. Mastering the content is really that summative assessment. It's usually done after a few lessons in the module just to make sure that we're assessing their understanding of that as they're working through. So they're building up to really understanding and fully understanding that. In the meantime, before they even get to those mastering the content, there's a lot of ways that students can self-assess themselves as they work through. So for example, this is all about t-distributions. It's giving us some information about it, and it has a video that has a whiteboard interactive. I'm going to mute that because it's going to start talking over me. But this is an interactive whiteboard video where they're going to show you how this works, what the distribution looks like. All of our videos are given captioning at the bottom to make sure that they're accessible. But there are different ways that this is presented. So this is one of our whiteboard activities. There are videos, there are interactive activities as well. So this is giving us a check your understanding at the bottom where students can type in a question. Sometimes these questions will be a matching question or multiple choice, or even sometimes it's, you know, making sure that they're, you know, calculating out the answers to some, you know, specific statistical math problems, and they have to, you know, go through and calculate it, enter that, and it'll give them a yes or no on whether or not it's correct. They'll be able to check their answer there on these formative assessments. Students will get the corrected answer or a sample answer for this one, a written response. But you as the instructor will not see how they scored specifically, just that they moved and completed this content. This is where we're looking at that low stakes. We want them to take risks. We want them to be trying and not just being afraid of getting things right or wrong. This is where they have that opportunity when they're in the content to, you know, try, make mistakes, learn things, you know, do all of those, all of the good things with learning. We don't learn everything by being perfect the first time. We always have to make some mistakes while we go. And we want this to be a safe space where students can do that. There are accessible versions and Word document downloads as transcripts for every activity in here. We want to make sure that we can, all of our learners can access the material in whatever format they need to. The drag slider bar at the bottom is where students have another way of self-assessing how they did on that specific topic. They can drag it up to "I completely understood it," or they can drag it down towards "I didn't understand," or somewhere in between. If you're feeling kind of not sure you did so well, or you're not totally sure, you can slide it down here, and they will often give you an additional learning object to support your understanding. So this is an additional quick 5 minutes of a review of t-distributions to give a little bit of additional practice, so that way students feel confident and comfortable with the content. You know, once they've felt like they feel good about it, they can change that and then move on. They will tell you that you can do this, or maybe you want to, you know, try this out anyway and move on to the next part of the learning there. So this one is the mastering the content for t-distribution, excuse me. In this specific unit, in this specific module, we have 1, 2, 3, 4 different mastering the contents, 4 or 5, might be 5. And those are varied depending on what content is being covered, how much content is being covered, because we don't want to do, you know, a ton of information all at once and then assess them all at the end. We're breaking it up so that way they can you know, really grasp that content and then assess how they're doing. So the mastering the content is where the instructor will see how a student performs. So these are generally multiple choice questions, but not always. Some are calculated questions where students have to enter numbers. Some are short answer responses. They're usually about five questions. Some have a little more, depends on the unit. And what happens with this is students have three chances to get 80% or better to receive full credit for their mastering the content. If they receive that, great, they move on. If they don't, then there's a few different things that'll happen. So on the first try, I'm just gonna wing it. And that usually gets me the results I'm looking for, which is usually not a pass, just to show you what it looks like. There we go, 0 out of 5. So it's showing me that I've gotten these questions wrong, but it is not giving me the corrected answer. So that way I can just go to my second attempt and just fill in the correct answers. No, what it's going to do is it's going to tell you that they're not correct. And they're going to give you some more things to check. Hey, you might want to review this again. You know, and you have two more attempts. You also can ask your instructor a question through this box down here. Once they've gone through and if on their second attempt, they don't get 100%, they'll go to their third attempt. It'll look the same where it'll give them an additional like, hey, look at this, check this over. And then on the third attempt, it will tell them what the corrected answers are, but they do not have any more opportunities to correct it. And whatever their score is will then be impacted up here on the learning goals completed. And also you will see their finished score on how they did in the instructor dashboard. So those mastering that content, that's that real summative, like how well did you really grasp this concept? Did you, you know, just go through and click through, or did you really take your time? And making sure that we are truly taking our time on these things. Another thing in the statistics specific PsycLearn curriculum that I really love is the fact that they have all of these different practice activities for, and they walk students through how to do a one sample t-test. And same with some of the other content pieces in statistics, z-scores, all sorts of stuff. So they go through and walk them through how we're gonna do this. So step one, do this and have them complete that process. You know, this is one where we have to drag whether this is equal to, not equal to, you know, less than equal to, et cetera, for these two based on this this data and concept up here. It goes through and walks them through each piece. It will tell them whether or not their answers are right. It'll help them through each part. So how well did you understand step one? How are you feeling? I felt like great about it. And then it'll tell me to move on. Let's move on to the step two. The way it's broken down is really helpful, and it gives students really a great way of, you know, practicing this before they come to you in your classroom to continue to dive in and apply this concept. And this is something that I feel like the statistics courseware does a really great job at. Like I said, there's a lot of different practices in here, different mastering the content, and then that learning summary at the end to give them that quick, brief overview. I think that's all I've got for this, the student view for today. But there's, we've got some more webinars, I believe, coming up for some more deep dives on some content. And I believe that's all I've got for today. So I'm going to switch it over to Dr. Ullman. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Nicole. And welcome once again, Dr. Ullman. Thank you for joining us and for your willingness to share a bit of about getting started on this project. I'd like if you would just to start by telling us about some goals you had in mind when getting started on PsycLearn Statistics for the Behavioral Sciences. As our editorial advisor, you brought a good bit of experience having taught statistics for a good while before beginning this adventure.
Thank you. Thank you, Linda. I was tickled actually when Linda was one of the people I talked to when I was approached to take on this project. Near and dear to my heart. I'm a quantitative psychologist. I love statistics. It's like a giant puzzle. It's fun. Students don't initially agree. So I think it's important both in my teaching practice and it's in PsycLearn. Students have to see why it's relevant. Why does it matter? Particularly if they're starting in that first stat class and they want to be in psychology because they want to help people. And it's like a cruel joke has been played on them that they're in a math class. You know, what? How could this be happening to me? So, I mean, the key, for, particularly in this, the class that this is geared for, you know, it's really important. A, their anxiety is through the roof for many of them. B, they have no idea why they're there. They're not happy about being there. And so, you know, you just have to dig through all that. And, you know, by the end, they like it. They enjoy it. But the key is to make it relevant. They need to understand why it matters. And you know, they're not, most of them will not go to graduate school and probably may or may not sadly be doing their own research in their undergraduate program, but they are gonna be citizens and they are gonna be bombarded with statistics. So it's so important. We have such an opportunity to help them learn these basic stat skills so that they can, you know, be good global citizens, you know, and then go to graduate school and do well there as well. So real life applications, A, because our long-term goal is to make good people or help them become good people. B, help them understand why on earth it is they're in a math, well, they'll look at it as a math class. And when they want to help people in psychology. So the more real life applications, in addition to the research applications, the better, because they can take a concept and you can help them link it to something going on in life, whether their life, you know, broader issue life. As soon as they can make those links, then they help, that helps their learning. So throughout this, we worked really hard to make sure that there were actual meaningful applications. I don't think, I'm positive, you could email me if you find one of these. There are no balls in urns. There is nothing like that. These are real life things, which are important. The other thing is, two other things in terms of goals. One, it's jargon. You know, in stats, we really have our own language. And it's a little bit clubby. And so the idea that to take statistical jargon and turn it into everyday terms, and I would joke, you know, at the family dinner with your friends at Starbucks, you may just want to share some of your new knowledge, but you have to do it in such a way they're going to get it, because otherwise in the classroom, we're just like a little club speaking another language. So there's a strong emphasis in PsycLearn to put things in everyday language. And that doesn't mean we simplify it. It means that it's exact, but it's in, we don't need the German, and we don't need the jargon. I'm sorry, I was looking at that. We don't need German either, particularly since probably you're teaching in English. But to make it exact and perfectly exact. So that's important. And actually, that is what students find that I have found. Students find that the most difficult. They love to be able to memorize things, memorize steps. They can chant, I'm going to reject the null. They're very good at doing that. But, you know, we want to teach them higher level learning. So we want them to know why, you know, why is it they're doing this? And what does that actually mean when you reject the null? Or what does an effect size mean, you know, in terms? So that was our other point. The other thing is getting back to that anxiety. Students have to experience some success. And they get just, and you know, I mean, your instructors, they know how it is stressful. My goodness. I remember my first stat class, I hated math. And my first stat class, nobody had even opened their mouth. I don't think we'd had the syllabus. I looked around the room. I went, everybody's smarter than I am in here. Oh my gosh, I'm not going to be able to do that. And I don't think I'm that unusual, you know, for first person taking a stat class. So what's good in here, the students can practice to their heart's content. And also what this does, which is great, students like steps. So they can see steps. So they get to have steps. And then they also get to do the harder part, the conceptual understanding. So the real life applications, taking out the jargon or introducing, you know, learning how to interpret that jargon, And then a lot of practice. So I think those are like the three things that I went into the project feeling like these are important things as instructors and staff. Did that answer your question, Linda?
That does. Thank you. Thank you very much. But something else that takes it a little bit further is helping to get students to recognize the value of statistics to their lives, to their future. So you did mention giving real life applications, but is there more?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, absolutely. So we give them real life applications, but then if we're asking them, and this PsycSat does this, you know, to make an application, and how does this apply? And then they're making this link, and they'll start ultimately down the line. They'll start seeing the links out there. Now this is just a little side tip. It's not in PsycSat, although we tease that a little bit. I had students write journals and find an example. And so they could do that and gradually link on. And there are some, that's not explicit in PsycLearn. Sorry, I've got hay fever going on, but they can find that there. So there's two things. When students start being able to interpret any jargon you can think of, t-tests, why does it matter, ANOVAs, effect sizes, z-scores, when they say, oh, wait a minute, I can explain this in everyday language, and you prompt them a little bit, and then they can start seeing it out in the world. And that's what the PsycSat product is doing, text replacement is doing. And you want them to develop those higher order thinking skills. So if you look at what employers want, you know, they want quantitative reasoning. They want, you know, the ability to work through complex problems. You know, if you look at all these different studies that come out, we're doing all that, you know, in STAT, and PsycLearn's doing, it's kind of set up to do that. So you're helping them at those levels as well. And it's fantastic. You know, soon as students start to see that it matters, or that there's some relevance, you've seen this, but it's fantastic. You know, there's just a joy, you know, that comes about. So it's really quite wonderful, but sometimes, you know, it's a little hard to get there, but they do. And I think PsycSat really helps with that. I hope it does, because we worked hard to make that happen. So.
Indeed. What about those students who are fearful or anxious about math? You've mentioned math or the other hurdles to confidence in this topic.
There's a lot of practice. So they can, you know, there's all sorts of practice. And we didn't have, you know, days to look at the different modules, but you know, some are math, you know, so they can work on the math. And students like, surprisingly enough, students like to do that because there's an answer. And so that helps them get that confidence. Okay, I can still do that. That sets a stage, maybe taps down a little anxiety. That sets a stage so that they go, okay, well, I can do that. Maybe I can think about something else. And then we've got all those short answer boxes. They can type in their answer and then they get a suggested answer back from that. They can do that at home, you know, whatever device they have. And so they can kind of quietly try things out, and then they don't have to, you know, talk in class if they don't want to. They don't have to talk to the TA or the instructor. They can get at least, we want them to, of course, but we can help them get like an initial feel, a little bit of confidence. And you know, the more confidence they get, you know, that taps down that anxiety. And I think this is well set up for success. Mm-hmm. And success that they can do quietly, and no one needs to know their anxiety level.
Mm-hmm. So confidence building through practice.
Yep.
And repeated practice with feedback is all important.
Okay. Yeah.
What wisdom do you have that you might could share for instructors who are new or experiencing challenges with teaching statistics?
Yeah, I'm fortunate in that my PhD is in stat, well, in quantitative psychology, but I think it would be daunting to suddenly have to teach stat when that your love and your passion is elsewhere, at least somewhat elsewhere, I would be comforted the knowing that this psychostat is incredibly well vetted, you know, at many levels. And I think the APA team, I'm just saying this quietly, I'm kind of picky. I think I want things perfect, as did everybody. So I think that you can have a lot of confidence that this is well vetted. And what's wonderful we're able to do is we're able to pull in, not so much we hear about the new statistics, but moving along current trends, effect sizes, where the field is going. So we've built that in, plus the other you know, necessary components. You know, I think with teaching stat, I hope that students are learn, and I hope it's fun. And I think that, you know, I think instructors can have some fun with this. When I was a brand new instructor, a mentor of mine, I thought it was just enough if students learned, and she's a brilliant teacher. And she said, you know, no, students have to enjoy it and learn. And I went, oh, that's true. And I think they can do that. So I think if for a new instructor doing this, there's incredible confidence that this is a solid product, in that it's not going to do wacky things or be out of date or any of the other things going on. And I think it's set up so that people can have, I mean, I think that's fun. But, you know, as a student told me in an evaluation one time, it's not fun when you don't understand. Clearly, I didn't hear the tone of voice, but we can imply it. Well, I agree. So it's stats hard, but yeah. Down the line, it can be, I think it can be fun. And I think it doesn't need to be stressful. I don't know if that helps. That's my little rah-rah for stats.
Yeah, it certainly sounds like it. And it does sort of bring me back to that thought I have about what I describe as the wiffle ball approach, the one where if we break it down and simplify and provide this moment of the baby steps moment in order to build confidence while you're skill building and knowledge building, then we can bring students along to enjoying and finding the joy and the value, the ongoing value of the skills that they'll have developed.
And you know, as instructors, you see things in the news, and you know, I think we're sort of careful about what we present or don't present. That really depends on you and your university, but you don't have to look around too much for like pithy examples of good stat to bring in, you know, to class that maybe don't say stat on them, but you know, that helps liven things up too.
Yeah. Well, that's great. Well, thank you so much for sharing these thoughts.
Well, thanks for having me.
We're glad to have you. And I'd like next to turn things over to Laura, who will describe some bit of how the PsycLearn statistics product came about on its development.
Well, thanks, Linda. And I always love talking and listening to Jodie. I learn every time. I'm glad to be here and able to share my experience. And I'm here for two reasons. I am the Director of Learning Design at APA. And as such, my team, which is comprised of authors and psychologists, as well as instructional designers and editors, we build PsycLearn. We produce the products, and my team work closely with Jodie and other editorial advisors on PsycLearn product. In addition, I am a psychologist. I'm a social psychologist, applied social psychology, and I teach. Right now, I'm a university lecturer at the New Jersey Institute of Technology, and I have taught a couple of as adjuncts at a couple of different institutions. And it has given me the opportunity to use the product that we are developing, which is both so affirming and humbling. So I wanted to first share a little bit about my experience using PsycLearn statistics, and then talk, as time permits, about some of the learning design that my team applies when we are building out the products. And much of that has been alluded to in various other parts of this webinar. So First up, my courses. So when I, go back for a minute, Andrea. So I'm going to talk about my courses, then I'm going to talk about how it's integrated in the class, and then I'm going to talk about my students' thoughts about PsycLearn as it was integrated in the class. And still hold on. So let me just set the stage with classes. So I had to chuckle off camera when Jodie said that, you know, she could imagine how terrified a new instructor might be when being handed the assignment of teaching statistics. And I, several years ago, despite the fact that I was advocating for the opportunity because I thought it would be a good idea to get PsycLearn into the classroom, it sort of horrified me when I actually was able to get a class that I would be teaching statistics, because I'm a social psychologist, I'm not a quantitative psychologist. And the initial class I got was an online stats class for a psychology department within a psychology department, and it was a 10-week intensive. So it was intended to be delivered online. This was pre-COVID, but they were teaching stats in this manner. And the only reason that I felt at all confident about going into this class was that I knew that I would be bringing PsycLearn with me, and that I felt that the product was going to be able to prop me up when I, in places where I was less knowledgeable about statistics than another instructor might be. And subsequently, the department decided, well, 10 weeks was good, let's make 7 weeks instead. And they did that in a 7-week intensive online, which I again participated in, as did my students, and we worked through the curriculum. And but challenging for both instructor and student alike, just that the idea of online statistics in such a short period of time. And but I've also used PsycLearn, I've used PsycLearn in a traditional class, face-to-face class in a 15-week format. So I've had a breadth of experience with the product. And okay, so now I'll go forward. So the way I integrated PsycLearn into the statistics class, and I extended this, it was initially set up for the online class, but it was extended as I got into a face-to-face format as well, is I would assign PsycLearn each week. I would assign a PsycLearn module, which in terms of amount of content is approximates what you would get in a traditional textbook as a chapter of content. And I would assign it and with points associated with it. So students were responsible for getting through that material. But in addition, there would be activities, and those activities in online world, they were conducted online, often using discussion. A discussion forum. In-person classes, they were done as in-class activities. And the beauty of PsycLearn was it really freed me up to be able to spend time with them, getting some of this more real life activity, real life relevance of the content, and finding ways to apply what they were learning. So here I've pulled just two, these are actual weeks of activities from my course. I'm reading right to left in order because it fit better on the screen. So in the probability module, the stats software I was using was JASP, and I had had them in an early part of the week, collect data so that they actually could understand how the relationship between data and people, and that we aren't talking just about numbers, but those numbers actually represent something. So now they're getting introduced to JASP, and as well as having activities that are around using JASP to make some, to do some kind of analysis. You can see that the analysis and the combating fake news statistical wisdom have points associated with this. These are just activities that are being conducted as activities in class outside of PsycLearn, but that there was also a PsycLearn probability z-scores and sampling distribution that they were going to be responsible for. And there was also a discussion called successes and challenges. I'll get to that in a minute, but I just want to run quickly through the hypothesis testing. module, because you see this there's the same format. PsycLearn, it's set up with 25 points so that students are paying attention, they're getting through the product. Like as they work through it, they are amassing points for their completion of the module. And then there are other activities, writing null hypothesis, writing null and alternative hypotheses, as well as to err as human. And so those are activities they're responsible for as well. Now, with the successes and challenges, if you can proceed to the next screen for a sec, Andrea. Okay, this particular activity, my students didn't know about my history with PsycLearn. I was not introduced as an APA anything. I was an adjunct and teaching this course. That's who they knew me as. And so, nor would they know necessarily that PsycLearn was related to, and in any way related to what I was doing outside of the campus environment. And so the assignment is to sort of acknowledge that people enter a stats course with some trepidation. Exactly what Jodie was talking about. Stats has a reputation of being, well, mathy, because it is mathy. But there are people behind the math, and they're going through, as you're going through this, I want them to reflect on their successes, because we've done a lot of, at this point, this is 4 or 5 weeks into the class, we've done a lot of activities that, and several PsycLearn assignments. I want them to reflect on what they're doing well, what challenges they're having. And the assignment was not graded on what they said, but that they participate and that they are sharing this with each other, because the idea is to be building, this was started as part of the online class. And so it was really to be building community and helping them feel kind of empathy with each other and like they're sort of all in it. And then they knew I was commenting and reading what they said. So hop to the next one. What I was particularly surprised by, and this was persistent across semesters, was that in that question that was structured in a way to ask what they were felt they were successful, where they were successful and where they were having challenges, is the number of students, which was more than 75% and for one class, of students who actually referenced PsycLearn in a positive way as one of the things they felt was successful. I do actually enjoy PsycLearn and find it works better than actual textbooks, says one student. I'm happy with the PsycLearn lessons. They are my favorite and very useful. And I was particularly struck with the language in this third one, which is, I'm also really liking PsycLearn. I really like having a chance to spend time on the concepts I do not understand before moving on, which really goes back to a comment Jodie recently made when she was talking about how the students having the time to build the confidence outside of the classroom is really a benefit that PsycLearn offers. And it was very encouraging to be getting this kind of feedback from students, because this is what I hoped, but I wasn't expecting that we were going to get it. Now, go ahead forward. So I know we're running really, really close on time. And so I just want to acknowledge that PsycLearn has a rich history, a rich foundation of learning science in how we create the content for our PsycLearn courses. And a couple of things that are really relevant here, these are the learning science principles that we really focus on when we're building our content. And, you know, as we work with Jodie, figuring out how we were going to deliver the material within the product. Backwards design is absolutely fundamental to how we develop our content. What that means is that we look at those learning objectives, the ones, you know, Jodie developed from the get-go on how her vision for stats and what she wanted students to be able to do at the end of a class. We took those learning objectives and you then figure out how are you going to demonstrate, how is a student going to demonstrate that they actually meet those objectives? And we create those assessments, formative assessments that demonstrate to themselves that they understand the material, that they've mastered it. Summative assessments that demonstrate to the instructor, to me, that they've actually mastered it. And then once you know what you're going to be testing, then you figure out how do you create the content based on Jodie's vision that is going to actually let students be successful in those assessments. And it doesn't stop there, because we made sure that as our content was developed for the learning objectives that were set, the content included the test bank content, because no sense testing students on something that wasn't part of what we were building content for. And we made sure that the activities, those in-class or out-of-class activities that we set up as part of the product, also met with the same learning objectives that we had established. So that's a really important manner of our development that is, I think gives me confidence. I know I can say with confidence to my department chair, this is what my students are learning, because this is how it's been developed. In addition, dual coding is something that gets talked about in instructional design. It's where you give redundant or different ways for students to be exposed to and interact with, engage with content, to have redundant channels. Cognitive learning scientists, cognitive psychologists, they have looked at the efficacy of that. And this is really consistent with Jodie's vision, because she wants us to be able, the student to be able to understand that jargon in a way that is not just the jargon, not just the concept, not just the formula, but instead is able to apply it to real life. And so if we are able to, in different ways, using videos or animations, let them also interact with it through our interactive activities, we're giving them the chance to really draw those connections that are so core to what the vision that she initially articulated. We've heard from Linda and saw from Nicole some examples of some of these other features. I think at a core, the fact that our material within PsycLearn is integrated, that is, a student gets into that module. When I assign a module for a week, I know that they're getting in there and the videos they need, the practice activities that I want them to do, the iterative algorithmically generated problems that I want them to engage with. Everything is within that module, and it's reinforced and it's built around these learning objectives and helping the student make sure that they're mastering them. That's what distinguishes PsycLearn and the way we've developed it. So with that, I will turn it back over to Linda and or Andrea.
Thank you, Laura. I just want to open this now to any questions that there may be. So Patricia says, I noticed that you use Jess. Do you just say it like that? I was wondering how a statistical package may interact with these modules, or if PsycLearn had a stats analysis component. I'm assuming using a package or not is up to the instructor. I introduced Jess about halfway through the course and students report liking it.
So we include some, include some data sets so that a instructor can pull that, direct the student to pull the data set and use it within whatever stats package that they are using in class. We do have some activities that are specific so students get some familiarity with as PSS, but generally speaking, we recognize that instructors are using different kinds of stats packages. So we do go in with some detail into Excel and how to organize data within Excel, and how Excel can, at a rudimentary level, especially for descriptive statistics, can be valuable for them. But we are leaving it to the instructor to take our data sets and use whatever package that works for them. Jodie, is there anything I missed in that description?
No, it's perfect. Perfect. And I would say, with the emphasis on Excel, you know, I've become more aware, and I've seen the importance of helping prepare students for life. And Excel is a critical skill. So I'm glad we have a lot of Excel in there, but all packages, you can find what you like, even R.
Again, if there are any questions, please feel free to submit them in the chat or the Q&A box. We're happy to answer anything you have. I definitely welcome questions, comments, thoughts, hear your experiences. I'd love to hear how you've discovered the joy of statistics. So if anyone would like to share that, we're happy to hear it. Looks like we have a question in the Q&A box. This question says, we are required to teach SPSS and SPSS has to be incorporated in the text. It appears as this, as it appears that this doesn't have that. So it is SPSS incorporated into PsycLearn stats itself, into the content.
I think it looks like Laura's frozen, or she's like ready to say something really profound. So she has a thunderstorm in her area. So this, it may have hit. I'm not sure, and you have to help me out here, anonymous attendee. I'm not sure that we don't ever provide syntax. And I don't think there are screens that say click here, but I'm pretty sure that there is output there. But again, I came in doing the objectives. I've seen pieces. So, and I am curious, in the statistics course, you'd want them to learn statistics, and SPSS or any software is sort of a tool to use. So are you saying that the only books you can use have to explicitly say SPSS? Wow. Oh my goodness. My goodness. We should talk to them. I don't know that it's explicit in there, although I'm almost certain there's output in there. So you could say they don't mention it specifically, but here's examples of output. Maybe that would help.
All right. And then we had a question in the chat that Nicole already answered, but I just wanted to put a voice to it. How do instructors receive messages that students send? Nicole replied, in the instructor dashboard, there's a messaging center. I apologize.
Well, and also students in each module can ask a question. And certainly when we were going through it and using it, it would startle me because I would just be trying things out and I'd type in a question that I get an email that I had a question. So the feedback, there's quite a few feedback loops built in there. So a student could be struggling and say, I don't know what this means, or I just can't do this or something. And then you would get that email right away. And then there's all the instructor tools, the dashboard tools as well.
Right. And good to point out that messaging, it can come to the instructor's email. It can be retrieved from the instructor dashboard, but it does include information that pinpoints the context in which a student is working when they ask the question. And we hear from instructor feedback that has turned out to be very useful.
On the Canvas integration, and I think others probably, I've got the big mouth, but no, it seems like when they've integrated Canvas on my campus, this with Canvas has worked fine. Same with Blackboard. I think that this isn't me at all, but the team that does that integration is really good. And that's from me as an instructor with very little patience point of view.
And that's my job, is to assist with the integrations with LMS. So that's a big chunk of what I do. And it is easy to integrate with Canvas. One of the things that I would suggest is making sure that you're like awarding it some sort of point value to make sure that it is calculating their grade correctly. It doesn't really love to work with pass fail or like complete incomplete in Canvas or other LMSs. But even if you don't want to necessarily award it a large chunk of points, some sort of point value of some kind will make sure that it really transfers their grades correctly into Canvas. Another thing that I thought is that I've seen for people, yes, you can absolutely do practice points. You can have it not calculate as part of their final grade. However you want to set that up, that's totally fine. And with the supplemental materials that we didn't really get to, but we've talked a little bit about, you can even have them come in to Canvas as, I say download as Word documents. And I have seen people set them up as like discussion board posts where they have students answer a specific part of the question and then respond to other people's posts as part of that. So that's something else that you can do with Canvas is pull things in as additional assignments from stuff that we already have created for you. So if there's additional practice that you want them to do, especially if you're doing a fully online course, you can easily integrate it into Canvas that way.
And there was a question in the Q&A also about detail, D2L Brightspace. Yes. So Patricia, yes, we also integrate with D2L.
Yes, we work with Canvas, D2L, and Blackboard most often, but we have worked with Moodle, even some schools have like their own proprietary learning management system that they've created themselves. We've worked with them. We've worked with one called Genzibar. We've worked with Schoology. You know, we try to make sure that we have, you know, some knowledge and ability to work with a lot of different learning management systems. And we work very hard to make sure that you all are all set up so that way there's nothing, hopefully nothing super frustrating on your end with getting things integrated.
All right, well, we've reached 4 p.m. So I just wanna thank everyone for being here. If there are additional questions, please feel free to reach out. The webinar recording will be available. I sincerely apologize. My daughter is having her first meltdown in the middle of all of this, and I am the only person that will keep her from melting down. You can learn more about PsycLearn at digitallearning.apa.org/PsycLearn. You can sign up for a free 60-day educator trial, and you can connect with us on social media. So thank you everyone for being here. We were happy to see you today, and we hope to see you again in the future. So thank you so much and have a great afternoon.